It reminds me, since John wrote up Duke Ellington, I'd like to bring up B.B. King. Sort of a whippersnapper music critic, not me. He asked B.B. King, do you ever make mistakes? And B.B. King said, sure. He said, if I make a mistake once, it's a mistake. If I make a mistake twice, it's genius. I would argue that when Joe Derrane, seldom that occurs, if he ever makes a mistake twice, it's genius. And I think it is so. So, we've been talking a lot, we've been hearing John play the mandolin, illustrating his points, but we haven't quite heard from Joe Derrane himself yet. So, without further ado, Joe, to come forward.
First of the amplifiers in the Boston area for made especially for accordion. And the reason that came about was that in the older days, in all the function halls, there were all the big grand pianos. But after a while, with the advent of electronic pianos, all the operators of the ballrooms or the clubs or whatever would say, well, hey, if you want a piano now, but your group is bringing your own. And they start taking care of the pianos over there, and they became to the point where they just were not playable anymore. So this, what happened is they went to electronic piano and piano recording, because if you put a nice quality amplifier on that thing, the left-hand side gave you the sound of the string bass, along with everything that was going on, right? And so it kind of substituted, if you will, for the piano. And Art would fly in from California, the agents loved amplifiers on the plane. He'd call me up and say, Joe, can you come up to the jazz club and dance with me 2 weeks from tonight? Have I borrowed your amp? This type of thing. And I got to know him and his son and his wife, and we were very good friends. Art then retired quite some years ago, and was out in Arizona. Art was knighted by the King of Sweden, given the medal by the King of Sweden. Wonderful, wonderful man. There were others, there were all kinds of guys that I met, guitar players, flute players, saxophone players, trumpet players. Sid Sullivan used to play lead trumpet for Boston Pops years ago. I met him at a wedding one time. I was doing what they call general business. I wasn't working with one special band all the time. This band would call you to do the job tonight, another band would call you to do a job the next night, and some other band would call you to fill in somewhere over here. It's what we call general business. And I was very, very busy, and you meet some wonderful musicians, and then this Sid Sullivan. And he introduced me to the Jewish youth. So I did about 4 or 5 years of Jewish music. And it was quite an idol. I liked it. I loved it. And he treated me very well. They always used to refer to me as the Goy, which is, I guess, kind of a nickname for someone who's under the destruction of the Jewish faith. That wasn't the case, but they say, oh, yeah, I'm not bad for a Goy.
You mentioned studying, Joe. You actually studied formally for a time at the Schillinger House, which is the precursor, by the way, to Boston's Berklee College of Music, which John McGann teaches. Why did you pursue a more formal or academic study of music?
Why? I had in mind that I wanted to learn how to be an arranger, arrange for bands, you know. care of. And I was working days, and I said, now how am I going to do this? And I went down to the calendar house, and I talked to somebody down there, and they said, well, what instrument do you play? And they said, well, piano accordion. They said, oh, we don't have any instruction here for piano accordion. I said, well, I don't want instruction in piano accordion. They said, well, no, you have to play one of the instruments. If you can play piano, for instance, they would take you in. I played a little Hammond organ. And they said, no, we don't have that either. Now, that was very funny. Well, to this day, if you really want to study formally, like, say, the New England Conservatory or something like that, you have an awful hard time to get in as a student if you play piano and organ. In many places, it's not accepted as an official instrument. It is in Europe, very much so. But it's getting better here. But back then, it was very tough. So I said, well, gee, I don't know, I'm quite disappointed. So they said, well, look, why don't we see if Dick Bobbitt can speak with the dean of the school? But it also turns out that he did an awful lot of arranging for Boston Symphony Orchestra and for the conductor of Hachey. He did a lot of work for Hachey and the Boston Pops, a lot of arranging. So I was just in this room, very, very expanded. He said, so you want to learn to arrange? And I said, yeah. And he said, why? I said, because I got a ballroom thing going on Gutter Street. We use saxophones and trumpets and occasionally a trombone and bass. And I like to arrange some of the tunes for it. And I said, because I have the outlet for it. Then, you know, when I write it now, I can bring this down to the ballroom. So he said, let's try this tune or whatever. That was it. And he said to me, well, you've got to really know your chords. So he said, let's find out what you know and what you don't know. So he said, I want you to write out all major minor chords, major sixths, sevenths, minor sixths, sevenths, right up to the ninths. In all inversions, that if you have three notes in a chord, if you rotate those notes in different sequence, it's called an inversion. But it's still the same three notes. It's like you take three oranges. If you put them side by side, you have three oranges. If you stack them up one on top of each other or arrange them in any other form, it's still three oranges. The chord is still the same way, except if you get a different lead note, the note that catches your attention. So it took me like 45 hours of homework just to write out this stuff. And I said, oh my God. You know, this is the way it's going to be. And I stayed with him for about 6 months. And I learned quite a bit. But then my day job changed. And I had to give it up. I was working on my own for state. And what I would do is I would go in and work early on my lesson day, say, one day. Go in very early. And then go back to after my lesson. My lesson would be like from 1 to 2 in the afternoon. But I was on my own as long as my work done. That was fine. But then I had to change my day job and somewhere else. That was the end of that. But I kept using all that knowledge and all that material all these years. And I tried to apply it. That's the way it is. It's a fascinating thing. The whole idea of music is just, it's a wonderful thing.